So now we carry on with more examples of pseudo-V complexes. For any subfamily F of n cubes in P, not necessarily finite, we have this notation WF equal to union of all the n cubes sigma which are present in F. We also have this notation F prime is all those sigma inside F which are maximal. What is the meaning of that? If sigma is contained inside tau, and tau is also in F, that means sigma is equal to tau. That is the meaning of maximal. Only the maximal elements of F are taken in F prime. Then clearly, the union of all the members is equal to union of all the maximal members. Okay. So this is where we use the fact that, you know, remember I will show you that interior of sigma, intersection interior of sigma 2 is non-empty implies either sigma is contained sigma 2 or sigma 2 contains sigma 1. Either they are overlap, non-overlapping, okay, completely, or one of them is containing the other. So you can take only the maximal one to take care of the union. Now, here is the extension of the earlier example for infinite case. So earlier we had this example for only on sigma. Now I am taking it for finite members of P. Let F be a finite collection of members of P. Let F denote the collection of all k faces 0 less than k less than 4n of members of F prime. So earlier there was only one sigma, now I am taking a finite collection. Then we can choose a function F on this large family F, okay, which is an integer value function, satisfying condition 1 and 2 of example 1.7. Let me recall that. What are these conditions? This is F tau is greater than R for all tau whenever this is a member of PR, tau 1 and tau 2, one containing the other implies F tau 1 is greater than equal to F tau 2. Okay, so this must be true for all now. All members of this curly F. Okay, so that is the condition 1 and 2. Okay, such that the CW structure sigma F, remember this is coming from 1.7, that example, for F in F prime, patch up to define a CW structure on WF so that n cells are in 1-1 correspondence with members of F prime. There, in that example, let F be with this property. I didn't say anything about whether there is one such chain and so on. There are many actually. Okay, but here I say we can choose a function F. If some F is given with these two conditions, I am not saying that this will happen. Okay, condition 1 and 2 are necessary even to have a CW structure on each sigma F, let sigma F. Okay, so once you have that, each K phase here, members of this one, will have this sigma structure. Now the claim is that if F is chosen properly, then these sigma structures, these sigma F structures on each of sigma will patch up to define a structure on WF itself. So this is the claim. Not only that, the second part says that the N cells of this structure are precisely the members of this P. with which you started with, which are maximal, namely F prime, the members of F prime. So if you have understood the sigma F earlier example, then this will be an easy consequence of that. Okay, so let me write down the formally what is the F. Let F from curly F to N be the function defined as follows. Take A tau to be all those sigma prime in F prime, the maximal members here, such that they will intersect the interior of tau. Okay. There is at least one, because each tau is a face of some F prime. Some member of F, therefore it is a member of F prime. Okay, so it's a face of some member of F prime. So this set is non-empty, but of course it is finite also. Anyway, all those sigma prime in F prime, sigma prime intersection, interior of tau is non-empty. So A tau is a, first of all, is contained inside P, so it's a non-empty finite set. Okay. We can take F tau to be the maximum of all T such that PT intersection A tau is non-empty. So each member of A tau belongs to some PT. If that PT is there, put that T in this set. Okay. So PT intersection A tau must be non-empty. So take those set. This is anyway finite set. It's non-empty also. So take this maximum, it is some finite number. So this defines F tau. As tau varies, this F tau will be different, doesn't matter. What you have to see is that it satisfies the condition 1 and 2. That's what we want, right? The condition 1 and 2 must be satisfied. Okay, note that if sigma is in F prime, intersection say PR, one of the members, sigma is one of the members in PR, as well as it's a maximal one. Then F of sigma is R, because this whole set itself will be just a singleton here, namely R. So it is maximum, it's actually equal to R itself. By the definition of F prime, because F prime is maximal, it will not intersect any other sigma prime. Sorry, sigma is maximal, it will not intersect any other sigma prime. It's maximal. Right? The interior does not intersect. So this will be only sigma prime will intersect. So that is the only member, so that will be R. Okay. You have to see that this satisfies the two conditions 1 and 2 in the above example. Okay. The point here is the interior I have put here. If the interior intersects, the sigma prime intersects the closure, the whole closure also, it will perhaps contain the whole closure. Sigma prime first. Okay. So that is the trick here. So if you take sigma prime intersection, interior of tau non-empty, and say tau prime is a face of tau, this will be true for tau prime also. So all those T which are present in A tau will be there in A tau prime. Therefore, this set will be a bigger set for tau prime than tau, which means that the maximum is bigger. Okay. So tau 1 contains a tau 2 will imply F tau 1 is bigger than equal to F tau 2, etc. You have to verify this. Okay. Hope you will be able to do it on your own now. Anyway, I have explained the second one. Condition 1 also, you can see what happens. Okay. So now the crucial thing in the lemma, namely, we claim that the CW structures F sigma, as sigma varies over F prime, patch up to define a CW structure on WF prime, which is same thing as WF. Okay. So we want to do an inductive step here, starting with Suppose F prime has only one member. That's already covered in the example. Okay? So therefore, we just want to do induction here. Alright, so write F as sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma p. So this is an enumeration of members of F prime. It's a finite family. Let us set the notation Wj equal to union of those sigma I for I less than equal to j. So W1 is just sigma 1, W2 is sigma 1 union sigma 2, and so on. Okay. So we will induct on this number p. If this p is 1, we know it already. There is nothing to prove. Nothing to prove means what? We have discussed this in the example 1.7. Inductively, assume that the structure sigma fi have patched up to define a CW structure on Wj. So I less than equal to j, suppose it is true for Wj. And that structure, temporarily, we shall denote it by Wjf. This is coming from F. Okay. Put next one, A equal to Wj plus 1, take the next member here, intersect with Wj, put A equal to that. If A is empty, you have two disjoint CW structure, CW complexes. Union is automatically a CW complex, in which Wj structure will be kept as it is, and sigma j plus 1 structure will be kept as it is. Both of them will be subcomplexes. There is no problem. Okay. The problem comes when A is non-empty. Right? So, suppose A is non-empty. The idea is to use our earlier lemma. So, let us denote the CW structure on A coming from Wj 1 and coming from j plus 1, sigma j plus 1. Okay, this intersection of these two things, right, respectively. Let us denote this one by A naught, that one by A1. Okay, what we wanted is that either A naught is finer than A1 or A1 is finer than A naught. Then we could have put them together. So that was our earlier lemma, right? So here we claim that A naught is actually equal to A1. So we are through. So you can patch it. And then induction would take care of it. Okay. So let us look at this. What is this A? A naught, A naught are structures. A is the subspace. A is the intersection of A is the intersection of W. This intersection never contains any interior of sigma j plus 1. It is exactly some part of the boundary. Okay, because sigma j plus 1, these are all maximal simplexes after all. So it is a boundary, part of boundary of j plus 1. A part of the boundary will be made up of k faces of sigma j plus 1 for k less than or equal to the dimension of sigma, namely n. Less than, strictly less than n. Okay, and hence the union of some proper faces of tau, faces tau of sigma j plus 1. On each of these tau, the CW structure coming from either side is precisely equal to that coming from P of F tau. By the very definition, F tau is what? The finest, maximum of all those things. And that's what we have chosen. Okay, maximum amongst all the members, not only just sigma j plus 1, for all Wj's, whatever F sigma i's are there, if they intersect, they will give you the whatever number there. So this is the maximum. So this is finer than all these, okay, it's either side. The CW structure coming from either side, okay. This proves that A naught is A1. So because it's actually equal to the P of F tau. So it just depends upon tau. It does not depend upon where this tau is, whether it is of sigma j plus 1 or of Wj and so on. Okay, so we can put them together. That's it. So from lemma, it follows that Wj plus 1 has a TW structure, which you will denote by WJ plus 1F, in which both the old one, the inductive step WJF and W sigma F are subcomplexes. Okay, so the structure keeps extending as you extend the space itself. Okay, so that completes the proof that WF prime has CW structure as proposed. And each time sigma, whatever sigma you are taking, sigma F has only one CW structure there because of F tau, F sigma itself is what we have observed, F sigma itself is R. Where was that? We observed that one, no? F sigma itself is R. Okay. So if sigma is in PR, there is no subdivision, it is just one single N cell. Okay, so it should be noted the final structure on WF, which is, let us call it as WP, does not depend upon the enumeration we have chosen on the members of F prime. And for J less than P, each WJ is a subcomplex of this WF. Okay, so it all depends upon my F. Once F is chosen, no matter, this is only for our convenience, that the enumeration was only for our convenience, okay, for the proof, but the final structure, so WF prime is nothing but WP here, okay, when the number of P is hit there, that structure is the same. So let us now go for infinite case. This was our aim finally. Let F be a family of members of P such that F prime is locally finite. So we are not into completely in the sea of all infinite families. That is not the aim. That is not possible either. So we allow F to be infinite, but locally finite. Let F prime be the members of all k faces, 1 less than or k less than or n. Of all members of F prime, you take subfaces and so on for once you start with F prime. Okay. Then there exists a function f on this F prime to n such that the CW structure sigma f patch up to define a CW structure on WF prime, namely it's the instance WF. So I am not saying here that F satisfies 1 and 2. Okay. So it should satisfy. Otherwise, I don't talk about the structure here. The structure sigma F is defined only when F satisfies the condition 1 and 2. Okay. So here, the finiteness is not there, you see, so you have to be a little more careful, but it is not at all that difficult. We start off as in the proof of the previous lemma. So let F denote the collection of all k faces of all members of F prime. Okay, observe that each set A tau defined as in the above lemma, A tau equal to set of all sigma prime in F prime is a set, sigma prime intersection interior tau is non-empty. This A tau is the same thing. Okay. This will depend upon all those sigma prime which intersect interior tau, in particular they intersect tau. By local finiteness, this family is finite. F prime may not be finite. So the sigma prime which satisfies this one, that is finite. So each A tau is finite, okay? Therefore, as before, we can take F tau to be maximum of this thing. That will be finite. So this is the replacement for family not being finite. The local finiteness takes care of this. Therefore, Okay, we have the function f, and it has satisfied the same properties 1 and 2, no problem. The second thing is, f prime is not just infinite, but it's countable. Why? Because p itself is countable. Okay, if it is finite, then the proof is over by the previous lemma. Okay, so assume that it is infinite and write f prime as, again, just like in the previous lemma, enumeration sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma j, and so on. The only difference is now this is an infinite family. We should take an enumeration. Okay, as before, put wj equal to the union of all sigma j, I less than equal to j. Okay, as in the example, for each j, okay, the CW structure sigma fi, I less than equal to j, patch up to define a CW structure on structure wfj on wj, which is a subcomplex of wfj plus 1. So all this is there in the previous lemma, because these are all finite now. Okay, this union of finite, many of them. It follows wfj themselves patch up, define a CW structure on wf. So each finite stage you have, and what is wf prime? It's union of these finite things. So one CW structure is subcomplex of the next one. Therefore, okay, look at any n cell or any k phase, whatever is in wf prime, it will be in one some at finite stage, and there things are nice, you can attach it. Okay, you know, attaching a k cell should make sense. How does it make sense? Provided its boundary is inside a k minus one skeleton. That's all we have to see. So that is automatically satisfied here. Okay. Also note that since interior of any two members of a primary disjoint follows that for sigma belong to PR, we have F sigma equal to R, same thing as in the previous case. Therefore, the N cells of WF are in 1-1 correspondence with member of F prime. There is no subdivision of the N cells. Okay. In other words, the proof of the previous lemma is ditto works provided this once a tau is finite for all tau, and that is ensured by local finiteness. That is all the difference. Okay, we now come to an important result, which I have, that's why I have put it as theorem, but this is also an example. But this will be useful. This will be used elsewhere. While studying manifolds, we will be using this one. This was our aim of doing all this fundamental work here. Okay. Take X to be any closed subset of an open set V inside Rn. So V is some open subset of Rn. X is a closed subset of that. I want to tell you right in the beginning that V could be the whole of Rn, and on the other extreme, X could be empty also. So that case is also allowed here. Okay, and they are of some importance also. Okay, they may be trivially true sometimes, but they are of importance. Okay, you can take just V to be any open subset and X to be empty, and that is one important case. All right, so X is a closed subset of a open subset V of Rn. Let A equal to all the members of P. P, remember, P is a union of all PKs. Such that this sigma is inside V. This is not some open set. This is some N cell. It should be contained inside V. And intersection of X with sigma must be empty. It should be away from X. That is my A. Second one is B is all those P, all those sigma in P, such that again sigma is contained inside V. So V is allowing us should not go out of V. That is the first thing. But the second condition is X intersection sigma is non-empty. Okay, so this is the difference between these. Are quite different. If X is non-empty, then these are different. If X is empty set, then this will be not there only. This is always true. So it will be just all those sigma which is there. Okay, so these two are quite different things, which are both subspaces of V. Okay, then WA, which is the union of all the members of A, and WB, which is the union of all members of B, are both n-dimensional CW complexes, which are countable, pure, and locally finite. Okay, so I am not including here when the case A and B may be empty and so on. So those things are obvious, you can just figure it out. Okay. So the proof is, though there are two statements here for A and B, they are similar. So I am going to put them together, that C denotes either A or B as above. As observed before, first of all, W over C, union of all members of C, same thing as W over C prime, which is C prime is what? A prime or B prime, which is maximal numbers of C. In view of the lemma, okay, all that we need to do is to verify that C prime is locally finite. That was our previous case. If it's locally finite, then we have the structure. Okay. So that was the previous thing here. It's a locally finite family. Then there is an F, then you have this sigma F patch up to define such a structure. Okay. So, in view of this lemma, all that we need to do to verify C prime is locally finite at all the points of WC. This is your union, this is the X, this is my X, whatever, or Z, whatever. Okay, so at all points, this family should be locally finite. Okay, so here is the proof. Take any point in WC, but choose epsilon. For epsilon positive, let us have this notation, standard notation, of course. U epsilon of X is the ball of radius epsilon, open ball of radius epsilon, centered at X. norm of x minus y is less than epsilon. So this is a ball in capital Rn, right? And this is an open ball, strictly less than epsilon. So this is open ball centered at X and having radius epsilon. So this is notation. Now choose epsilon such that this ball is contained inside the open set V minus X. If we are working, namely C equal to A. C equal to A, X belongs to WA, which means that X is not a point of capital X, and its X is, of course, a point of V. So it's into V minus X. Whenever V minus X is an open subset, we can choose epsilon sufficiently small set. U epsilon of X is contained inside that. So that is no problem. Similarly, in the second case, U epsilon X is just contained inside V. Okay, in the second case, this is easier. The first case, you have to throw away X and then take that open set. Once you have taken U epsilon contained inside V, this U epsilon is going to ensure local finiteness. We claim that only finitely many members of C prime will intersect U epsilon of X. The emphasis is on C prime. If you ask for C members of C, that is not true. Here it is definitely not true. May not be true is not correct. Not true at all. Okay. Only for C prime it is true. finitely many members of C prime will intersect with S prime. Local finiteness is for C prime at every point. Okay, let us prove this one now. Given any R, okay, clearly there are only finitely many members of PR which intersect a given bounded set. Take a bounded set inside R. Members of PR will intersect it. Okay, because bounded set is inside some large square, and inside the large square, large cube, only finitely many members of PR will be there. Okay, when R is fixed, given any fixed R, this is true. Okay, hence, in particular, how many will intersect UA, U epsilon X? U epsilon X is a bounded set. Finitely many will intersect. Okay. Therefore, there are only finitely many members of, if take all the S less than equal to R, each of them will contribute finitely many. So you have only finitely many for PR, R, union of PR, where S is less than equal to R. Okay. The problems comes with members of PS where S is bigger than R. That means these are smaller cubes. They can create problem. But this is the point is here. We shall see that none of them belong to C prime if R is chosen appropriately. U epsilon is already chosen. If I choose R sufficiently large, after that, no PS will intersect U epsilon of X at all. I mean, PS, they will intersect, but they are not members of C prime, sorry. They will not belong to C prime. So number of members of C prime which intersect U epsilon will be finite. They will be coming from here only. Okay. So once I have said this one, it should be obvious to you, but let me just make it more clear. To choose R, let R belong to N be such that this number, this is a real integer, square root of N divided by 2 power R minus 1 is less than epsilon. This 2 power R minus 1 is side length. But what is square root of N? The square root of this denotes the diagonal of any N cube of side length 1 by 2 power r, 2 power r minus 1. So that's why the square root of n times 2 power r minus 1 is there. So diagonal should be less than epsilon. Let f be the collection of all members of pr. Now r has been chosen correctly, okay, which intersect u epsilon. Okay. Look at all those, they will intersect u epsilon. Then this u epsilon of x be contained in the interior of all these WF. F is all of them which intersect. It will be contained inside W. Okay, like if I have single point, for example, if I take all of them, it will be a bigger cube of side length double of that one, 2 power R, around that point. Similarly, if I take an edge also, that will do the same thing. So this may not look like that. It may be bloated up thing, but it will be some open set. That open set will contain U epsilon of X. Okay, it will be union of cells after all. Okay, so this is what you have to understand why this is happening. It's elementary geometry, whatever topology which is inside Rn. Okay, suppose. Now, tau is in PS where S is bigger than R. And tau intersection U epsilon is non-empty. Okay. So, this is some member NQ in PS where S is bigger than R, which is very tiny member. S is bigger than R here. Okay. So, tau intersection interior is non-empty. This intersection, tau intersection epsilon is non-empty would mean that interior of tau will meet the interior of this larger one, because this is open subset contained inside this open set. Okay, if some tau intersects, interior tau intersects this open subset here, which must intersect one of the interiors of members of this one. Okay, so it will follow that interior of tau will meet the interior of WF and hence will meet the interior of some member sigma of F. Okay, so this tau intersection, interior tau intersection sigma, that is non-empty, that will imply that tau is contained in that sigma. Okay, if tau is smaller size, sigma is of size R, where S is bigger than R, so it cannot be that sigma is inside tau, but tau must be inside sigma. Both tau and sigma are inside C. Therefore, I mean, that's what I want to say. Let me see how. If both of them are inside C, only one of them can be inside C prime. And sigma is already in C prime, so tau is not in C prime. So he wanted to show that none of these taus are in the C prime. Right? So why both of them are in C? That's what I have to see. Okay, so that's easy. The case A equal to C equal to A and B have to be done separately. In case C equal to A, what does this imply? Both tau and sigma belong to C. Why? Because interior of tau, you see, what is the definition of C here? Go back. Okay. A, definition of A. Sigma intersection X is non-empty. If tau intersection X is non-empty, sigma intersection X is also non-empty. And both of them are, sigma itself is inside V, tau will be also inside V. So both of them will be inside A, right? So that is the case when, similarly, the other one, but this one is more, C is A, both of C and tau are inside A. Therefore, tau is not inside A prime. Okay, now consider the case when C is B. Okay, now it's something different. Then it may happen that tau intersection X is empty. Okay, but we want members of B to be that tau intersection X is non-empty. If this is empty, that would mean tau is not in B. Already, if it's not in B, it cannot be in B prime. So that case is over. Now, on the other hand, tau intersection X is non-empty, then tau is, sigma intersection X is also non-empty because sigma is larger. Both of them will be inside B. Once again, tau cannot be inside B prime. So that completes the proof that these both A and B have a nice CW structures. N-dimensional CW complexes which are countable, pure, and locally finite. You can further assume, which I am not going to use, but you can further assume that the n cells in each of them is equal to, I mean, they are coming from in 1-1 correspondence with members of A prime or members of B prime respectively. That can also be assured. Okay. I want to make one more remark. WAs, which I have made already, I want to draw your attention. Note that WA is exactly equal to V minus X. Take any point in V minus X, then there is a positive distance of that point to the complement of V minus X. Okay. After that, you can choose a small neighborhood U epsilon, which is completely contained inside V minus X. V minus X is open subset. Then if R is large enough, then square root of n divided by 2 power r minus 1 will be less than epsilon. And so the smaller and smaller disks will intersect. Okay. Therefore, what we get is WA is actually equal to V minus X. That means V minus X gets a CW structure. If X is empty, what we conclude? Every open subset of Rn can be given a CW structure. Every open subset. Okay, so that is the conclusion of this one. Further, all these CW structures are so nice, they are all made up of n cubes. Just star them. Okay, each face of each of these n cubes, the starring will take care of that it will become a simplicial complex. Therefore, what we have proved here is every open subset of Rn can be given a simplicial complex structure. Okay, so we will use them in studying manifolds. Okay, here are some easy exercises for you. Try them, keep trying them. If we don't get them, we are here to explain it to you. Our TAs will explain it to you and so on. Okay, so that's it for today. Thank you.